Today, I'm joined by BJ Kraemer, host of the Inspiring People and Places podcast and president and CEO of MCFA, a veteran-owned small business specializing in project development and program management advisory services in real estate, defense, federal, healthcare, higher ed, and infrastructure sectors. BJ, thank you so much for your service, first of all, and welcome to the show.
John, thanks so much. It's awesome to be here. Excited to jump in.
Excellent. In your bio, it says you've got three young children. I've got three young children myself, 8, 6, and 4. How old are yours?
Mine, I was going to say, holy shit, 8, 6, and 4, but they're actually 9, 7, and 4 now.
Oh, wow.
I had two birthdays in December, so 9, 7, and 4, and the four-year-old turns 5 next month.
My oldest and youngest, their two birthdays are right around December and Thanksgiving too. So yeah, it's birthday season, we like to call it.
Yeah, that's right. It's money season from Thanksgiving to Christmas.
Raising kids ain't cheap, that's for sure.
That's right.
Well, BJ, actually, it's kind of a good segue. I coached my son's little league team for a while, and he's doing soccer now. And I saw that your nonprofit foundation, the Friendly Strife, is focused on veteran and youth sports related initiatives. On your website, it says, as a lifelong athlete, you believe in the power of sports to teach, inspire, and prepare athletes to be leaders of character beyond the sports field. As an athlete growing up myself, I can totally relate to that message. Can you share like a couple examples of what you're doing with the Friendly Strife Foundation?
Yeah. So let me put a little more context. I was a lifelong athlete. I still try to be, at least.
You still get in the pool?
At least a fitness enthusiast. From time to time, I get in the pool. That's the one place that's really, really hard to fit into the schedule.
Yeah,
running, you can tie up your shoes and start right away. Pool requires a lot more planning in your battle with them. Friendly Strife, first of all, comes from a quote that we had to memorize first summer at West Point. Upon the fields of friendly strife are sown the seeds that upon other fields on other days will bear the fruits of victory. It's by Douglas MacArthur. And basically his stance was every cadet needs to be an athlete because athletics is a place that you learn a lot about leadership.
Yep.
and the fields of friendly strife and comparing the sports fields to the battlefields and, you know, learning those lessons. So that's where the foundation name comes from. I sit on a couple of different boards, and this was a place to kind of bucket kind of all my community-based philanthropic efforts and really passion projects. So one project we are working on is a pilot, leadership character and resiliency, I'll call it, curriculum and program with a high school athletic department to basically give coaches a curriculum. You know, we're used to sports, two thoughts. The best coaches tend to be people that care about these three things, right? They care about things other than the X's and O's. The world tries to force us into only caring about winning and losing. What I'm trying to do is to make it easy for them to care about the character development of the kids and using the sports field or the pool and all of the things that go on in practices as a co-curricular platform for really teaching what I think are the most important skill sets. You know, X's and O's in the sports field, call it the technical details of whatever career path or whatever education path you take. But these are the life skills of human interaction and teamwork and camaraderie and leadership and perseverance. And I think it's really important to use, I personally didn't connect with teachers as much as I connected with coaches. And I think there's a level of vulnerability that needs to happen in that relationship to really have the level of connection on the soft skills. It just can't happen in a classroom. So you have to turn the sports field into a classroom. Man, I could talk all day about this. So I don't want to get too off the rails, but I would say that the primary initiative we're doing there is building that curriculum. And I'm working with a couple of other coaches and sports teams to kind of refine that curriculum and look at how, essentially, how do you make it really, really easy to implement? I was inspired by Mike Irwin and Jeff Bryan and the Positivity Project because they're doing it in the classroom. And I'm basically trying to do the same thing, but on the sports field.
That's really cool. I've always, growing up, playing sports, I've always found that I've applied some of the lessons that I've learned on the field to my work, you know, working with teammates, being a part of a team, kind of overcoming adversity, right? And
for
working
sure.
hard, right? So like there's like definitely some takeaways. At least
and make no mistake about it. The number one thing I take away is competitive.
Yeah. Oh, of course.
I like to win.
Yep. Yep. But learning how to do that effectively, right? And learning how to do that with humility. And I think that's part of like the biggest thing, because, you know, you can be over competitive to your own detriment as well. Anyway,
sure.
Yeah, I could talk about that all day too. And that's why I wanted to ask you about it, because I'm really, that's something that I'm passionate about, especially as a father of kids who are doing sports.
Yeah.
But let's talk about your podcast.
Sure.
Inspiring People and Places. You launched it in Q2 of 21. You've got over 140 episodes at least at the time of this recording. You publish on a weekly basis. First of all, kudos for committing to a weekly cadence. That's no small feat, doing that every week.
Perseverance.
Right, exactly. I'd like to start at the beginning. Why did you launch a podcast? How did you come to that decision?
Can I actually comment on the cadence first?
Sure.
The only way that you do anything successful around a podcast, in my opinion, is by creating a cadence. So you have to, I told my team, I'm treating this, so I'll talk about how we got there, but I said, I'm treating this like I'm going to high school. And then we're going to figure out if I'm going to college. So you are a nobody freshman year of high school. You got 4 years to become big man on campus. So I looked at it and I said, I don't want to judge whether this is a good idea or not for 4 years.
Wow.
I want us to look at the data, and I want us to try and continue and improve. It's like give ourselves a report card, but I'm committed for 4 years to doing this, because I think it would be too easy to walk away. So I said, if it's like quitting a diet because you didn't lose weight in 2 weeks, like
right.
you got to commit to being on the long haul. You have to have kind of a long view of the game. So let me start with that. Your question was, why did we commit, or how did we start the podcast?
I guess like the decision to, yeah, why a podcast and why not like a webinar series, or why not a different, you know, marketing vehicle for your firm?
So like probably most entrepreneurial leaders, you see everything and you're like, I want to do it all, right? Why don't I have commercials on TV and billboards at sports games and all that? Here's what I think. When I was young, everywhere I would go to sell, they would try to hire me day one. They'd be like, I don't need your company. Why don't you just come work for us? And I was like, man, this is really hard to separate myself and my company. Like, I'm trying to sell myself, but I'm really representing a company, blah, blah, blah. And then there was other times where people would find out about my resume 7-8 months into a relationship and be like, I didn't know all of that about you. So a podcast felt like the most natural platform to slowly build rapport with people over time without having to be in your face, self-promote-y, Instagram model in today's current environment. The second piece is I think it's a blue ocean in the architect, engineering, construction industry. There's not a lot of, I don't think big companies can put, they can put podcasts out there. They can't put a personality out there. I'll be specific. The world looks at professional services as commoditized buckets. A law firm is a law firm is a law firm. Okay, that individual at that law firm may be the best in the business in real estate or whatever. And accounting firms and accounting firms and accounting firm. The big five only become the big five really because of size. Now, size eventually is built off of reputation and systems and the professionals they attract. But like, they're really almost brand agnostic when you come to looking at professional services firms. And that the same is going on in the engineering industry. Mm-hmm. So it was my way of saying, like, what's different about us? I don't know. There's a lot of things that are different about us. I can't. I can say them in a phrase, but you can't feel them and believe right. them in a phrase. That's like, oh, we're business case focused. Well, what the hell does that mean? I don't know. I was talking to somebody recently about, I don't know if I heard this. No, I read this in a book called The Monk and the Missionary. No, The Monk and the Merchant. I don't know if I read it or if this was my takeaway. So forgive me, anybody that's read the book and is like, that was not in that book. This is how it triggered in my head. I've always talked about the message and the messenger being aligned. Mm-hmm. There's a third person that you have to think about, and it's the recipient of the message. So I might have the right message. I might be the messenger, right messenger, but if the recipient isn't in the mood to receive it when I put the proposal in front of them, it doesn't matter. If I build this huge rapport by interviewing my own people and interviewing some of my clients and interviewing some of my partners and talking to thought leaders in the industry, and like over time, people get to know me, they're getting to know my firm, and they're getting to end, oh, by the way, because it's a disciplined cadence. You can lie once in an interview. You might be able to lie two or three times in an interview. You can't lie consistently about who you are, what your intentions are, what you're trying to be. I'm far from perfect, and I say that all the time. But I am what I am, and I want people who are buying from us to know who we're trying to be. Because when I make a commitment out there on a podcast, I'm actually creating a higher level of accountability for anybody that does business with us and for anybody who works for us. So that's a lot to that, but it was essentially, I saw it as a blue ocean, and I thought it was the best way to promote without being self-promoting.
So there's a couple of things that I want to unpack there, because I thought you dropped a lot of really great advice and a lot of kind of sage words of wisdom. So first of all, the commitment to 4 years. Mm-hmm. 4 years is a long time, but based on my research and interviewing successful podcasters, that's what it takes. So I interviewed Jeremy Clopton and Heath Alloway from the Upstream Leader podcast a few weeks ago, and they told me a similar thing. They committed to a year. They were going to do it for a year, and then they were going to revisit the podcast and see if it made sense, and it did for them. And so they they reneged at another year. And so that's the way they operate. And so I think that that's really interesting. Another thing that you mentioned that I think is critical in professional services is the concept of building trust. And a lot of firms, I worked at a branding agency called Hinge for nearly a decade. And one of the things that we uncovered in our research was that so many professional services firms claim their people as a differentiator, right? But you can't just say that. You have to show it. You have to have folks experience what it's like working with you. And I think a podcast is a great medium to do that. But it's not just, you know, do I want to work with you? And that's why I listen. You know, folks need to be entertained. You need to be able to hold attention, right, with a podcast. So I want to ask you, like, in your podcast trailer before every episode, you mentioned that your podcast is focused on getting away from negativity of the news and divisiveness of politics to highlight the good news stories of public servants and private partners working together. I guess, BJ, what are some of maybe the most memorable stories you've heard on your podcast?
You're catching me flat-footed on that one. Sorry. It's all right. Let me go in a different direction, because I'll tell you what inspired that thought.
Okay.
The Corps of Engineers was where I made my home as an active duty Army officer. I was a resident engineer on a construction program. And I saw all of this stuff going on day to day that's like all newsworthy. Like if I was an Instagram guy, I'd be like, oh man, look at that going on, and like cool building being built and whatever. You see a lot of cool stuff going on. But the news loves negativity, and when you're in election years, the political side of the news loves divisiveness because it sells. And I saw way back when not Superstorm, Hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans, there was two big issues around Hurricane Katrina. FEMA didn't move fast enough, and the Corps of Engineers, the levee failed.
Right.
It's the Corps of Engineers' fault because they built it. Well, yeah, they built it, but Congress funded how big they could build it. And the science said to build it bigger. And Congress may have said, we can't fund it all. So there's a lot of these things that get kind of, there's nuance to how decisions are made and what actually happens. And the Corps of Engineers is doing a lot of good work in their mission. And so are a lot of public agencies at the local level, at the project level. And I had a lot of mentors that I was like, man, these are some of the smartest people that you're going to find. Like, these people need to have voices out there because the news only represents what's selling. They're not representing the true story. So I look at engineers, let's use swimming as an example. Swimmers only get attention once every 4 years at the Olympics.
Right.
But in order to keep everybody's attention, you've got to have kind of the human interest story behind the swimmer. Michael Phelps just had his baby and we're talking about his baby, or we're talking about how he had ADHD as a kid and doing interviews between his mom and his coach about how. That's what gives some level of information and entertainment to the actual event that is swimming. Well, similarly, engineering is like a bunch of shit has to happen for projects to happen and for projects to go right. And a bunch of people need to work together. So I want to talk to those people and bring them onto the show and give life and give story and give human interest and education backgrounds and career trajectories and failures and successes to these people to kind of tell people like, hey, all of the built environment, the houses that you live in, the water that you drink, the utilities that you turn on, the hospital that you go to get healthcare, the buildings, that there's like really smart people working really hard to figure out how do we underwrite these investments and how do we manage and maintain these projects and operate and maintain, you know, the key bridge down in DC or Maryland doesn't get attention until it collapses.
Yeah.
Now everybody's like, man, really, that was really important infrastructure. So that's kind of my answer to your yeah. question.
No, that's really, you bring up, I love the comparison with the athlete and Michael Phelps and looking at the backstory and bringing attention to and giving engineers and architects and project managers a platform to really see the people behind the profession, because you know that at the end of the day we're all human, right? And
Amen.
We bring a level of emotion to our work. And for better or worse, you know, there are the stories behind the people and that impacts the jobs they do. So
yeah.
I think you're doing a great job at highlighting the human element of your industry.
Thanks.
How has your podcast, I know that you're in the sophomore year of your 4-year journey?
I guess it's junior year.
Junior year now?
It might be. I guess it's going junior to senior year, really. But okay. Yeah.
Well, have you seen the podcast impact your business? I know you're not at the 4-year mark, but what level of impact have you seen? And maybe can you share some examples?
Yeah. So I don't know if you know Russell Brunson and ClickFunnels. Are you aware?
I'm aware of ClickFunnels. Yeah.
Okay. So there was this like, and I'm not giving up on the idea, but there was a bit of a bet in my head that like, I'm going to change the RFP game. I'm going to get so many people understanding who it is that we are, what it is that we do, and why we may be a differentiator for that buyer, that they're like, I don't need an RFP. I know exactly who I'm going to, and they're going to listen to the podcast and they're going to be inspired to my call to action. And they're going to be like, we're hiring this team because we have the exact same project, exact same problem. They understand all of my frustrations. They're the answer. Click here and buy from MCFA today. I joke about that, but like that is what conceptually was in my head around a podcast, is that you reverse the business development trend. Now I get to have coffee with somebody over a podcast instead of one-on-one having coffee with them in person. Mm-hmm. And if they get to know me and us over time and we happen to be the right team for them, they're just going to start calling.
You're accelerating like pipeline velocity, right?
Correct. Man, if I can talk to one person on a Saturday over coffee, now I can talk to a thousand.
Right.
If we get this distributor right. And then I'm so inspiring that they're going to obviously click and buy. That has not happened. So anybody that has the pipe dream that like, hey, you do a podcast for a year and all of a sudden leads start just piling on you, it's not accurate. No, there's probably some marketers out there that'll say, dude, I can increase your conversion and I can dial in your call to action and I can increase your distribution. Blah, blah, blah. Has it worked? It has. It has allowed us to build stronger relationship in the marketplace. I've had our clients on, which allows me to have a stronger relationship with them. They appreciate being highlighted as a public servant doing really good work. I have had clients say, I heard you talk about this on the podcast and I saw it in your people in this interaction or that interaction. And, you know, MCFA is not just talking about it. They are doing it. And I wanted to let you know. So there's been a whole bunch of account client relationship confirmation that what we're doing is working and what we're doing is true. And that's really what's validating. Keep going. I'll be honest. There are weeks where I'm ready to throw in the towel and I'm like, the ROI on this is not worth it. Like, this is a lot of time. This is a lot of commitment. I got to think about this and I got to pay for this. And then there's weeks where I'm having a blast doing it. And I think as long as I'm having fun on it, like, I don't even care about the ROI from a direct to sales. I care about it because I think it's becoming the platform by which I can think out loud with people. I can have good conversations with people. I might be able to plant a seed in a young professional about how they're going to build their career. And I think the long-term ROI on impact, not necessarily dollars, is going to be there. So if nothing else, I've built a platform for us to tell the world what we think right looks like and what we think good looks like and how we think you get there. And make no mistake, I want it to be high ROI revenue and marketing, but if it's making an impact and is at least break even on revenue and marketing, I'm pretty happy. And so far the anecdotal evidence is it is a strong account management and branding tool.
Totally. Yeah. I love the way that you said that it deepens your relationships with clients when you have them on the show. I think in my experience as a podcast host, one thing that I've done in the past is I worked at an agency, a digital marketing agency, and we had a client on with their account manager, both, and they had a conversation and I was kind of facilitating that conversation. But what it did was it showed the working relationship between our people and the client and the kind of like the energy that happens between those two. And it was really powerful. It was like a case study, right?
Yeah.
And it was used as such. So I think that's really cool.
So that's interesting. Let me, everything we're doing on a podcast is bringing to life what used to be in print. And everybody needs it in their face. They need to hear it. They're listening to, let me qualify this. Not everybody I want to do business with is listening to podcasts, but the best people I do business with are the people listening to podcasts, because guess what? I listen to podcasts and people who listen to podcasts are into improving themselves. And yeah, therefore I know that the clients that are into improving themselves are open-minded about doing things differently. And that's kind of how we consult. So there's a macro psychographic client thing that I'm doing also. I don't want to do business development with people I should not be selling to. The podcast is a way to remove those people. There's a lot of people in the government that are bureaucrats and they all they want is the cheapest thing and all they want is that I don't want to do business with those people. I want to do business with the people that are like really intellectually curious about how to be better project leaders, really intellectually curious about how to improve their project team or how to be more innovative inside of what Guy Kawasaki would call intrapreneurship, not entrepreneurship. The best clients I have are really intrapreneurial. They love their job. They love the mission that they're working for, but they're also trying to be creative and do things better and smarter inside of their organization.
Well, and that results
that's
in
who
a better
I want
project.
Listening to my podcast.
And that results in a better project, a better outcome, right?
You and I know that, but like, there's a big industry out there that does business the way they've done business because they've always done business that way.
Yep. Salary, same as last year.
I'm not that company.
Right.
And if you want the big bureaucratic tried and true, you don't want me. I'm trying to slice through the bureaucracy and I'm trying to be really consultative and I'm trying to color outside the box.
I think that's a really interesting point because your podcast is attracting the kinds of clients that you want to work with based on not just their demographics, not just their firmographics, but from their mindset.
Yes. The individual, the human psychographic of my buyer, what you could in marketing terms say I'm doing is I'm taking a B2B model and B2B industry and turning it back to a B2C, right? Okay. I'm not looking at selling an RFP to a procurement department. I'm looking at selling my team and my philosophy and my people and my brand to a buyer, a human being. And then when that human being is on the RFP panel and they're one of the, they're that much more motivated, like I'm finding a way to get to them.
Yep. They become a champion of your brand.
That's the hope. 4 years isn't going to be enough. I'm probably going to have to commit to my doctorate here. It's going to be a 10-year battle, but I'm going to get there.
Oh, that's good. So you mentioned that you want to double down on it. It might be a graduate. I guess what's next for Inspiring People and Places? Where do you take the show from here?
So I'm going through a little bit of a coaching program right now. We're contemplating a rebrand, which I have a love-hate relationship with. And this is why, if people are listening, anybody that says the riches are in the niches is correct. And Inspiring People and Places says nothing about planning or project management or construction management or the AEC world or any of that. So that's one thing we're talking through. The number one title we came up with has IP on it. So it's been copyrighted. So we're kind of back to the drawing board. Two, I'm dialing in our cadence and our rhythm. I've been told that people want to hear from me and that most podcasts, when you start building a following, they're as much as I think they're following kind of the people I interview, the feedback is they're probably to some level following you. So we're going to try and get to a 50-50 solo episode to interview cadence, working through that. And I'm trying to improve the interview, the guest, the guest list. I think that there's a lot of value to who you're interviewing. And my job is to make anybody I interview feel interesting in their story, because I think everybody does have a human story. As you know, interviewing, you need people that are really excited to talk, to have a great conversation. And as you may imagine, there are some engineers that are like, they'd rather give one word answers than one paragraph answers.
Yep.
And that makes, you know, the conversation maybe not as exciting or as enjoyable. So we're dialing in our guest list and we're trying to get to the real thought leaders in the industry. What's interesting, what I said before, is this is a blue ocean. You know, real estate, as an example, whether it's real estate sales or real estate investing or real estate development, I mean, there's a freaking cottage industry on thought leadership in the real estate world. There's not that much out there in Instagram or LinkedIn or podcast world for engineering or construction management or project management or professional services. So I think it's a blue ocean. So I'm a first mover, or at least an early adopter.
Sure.
Which means I'm pioneering it a little bit. And I'm not like trying to look at me. I'm saying like, it's freaking lonely because there's not a lot of people to collaborate with. And it's like, hey, you get on my podcast, I'll get on your podcast, yada, yada, yada. So we're, you know, I think a little ahead of the curve. And this is, I often joke that AEC, Architect, Engineering, Construction, stands for archaic, expensive, and complicated. It's an archaic industry a little bit, which means I got to commit to the 10-year, not expect the 4-year payback. Sometimes I'm like, this probably would have been easier in another industry. You know, I got the cadence, I got the production down, I got, like, we're doing a lot of the right things. Again, lots of things to improve. But man, when's this thing going to go viral?
Well, you know, the grass may be greener on the other side because many other industries are really competitive. And like,
that's true.
Launching a marketing podcast, you're going up against thousands of other ones. One thing you mentioned about, you know, having more of a 50-50 split between interview episodes and maybe solo casts or monologues.
Yeah.
I thought that when you and John got together and kind of interviewed, he interviewed you. I thought that was a really interesting kind of way to think about it too, where I co-host a podcast called Breaking Biz Dev with Mark Wainwright, and he and I just kind of have a conversation, just the two of us on the show. And then from time to time, we'll pull in clips. But what that's done is it's given us a lot more flexibility in terms of when we can record, scheduling, because it's just the two of us, right?
Totally. That is the other reason, is like you could build backlog of episodes in a 4-hour like block of time, and you have 8 episodes recorded, and you're giving more of a peek into the tent. If you use John and I as an example, that's my CFO and me talking about everything that we're wrestling with and thinking about on projects with clients in the marketplace, what are our challenges. I do think there's a human element to our business that you get to see in that too.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, one point I wanted to, and I remembered the question that I forgot, totally slipped my mind, but you jogged my memory when you talked about the blue ocean strategy. About 10 years ago, you know, there was still not enough information available on the internet to search for, right? And so you could create blog posts, editorial content, you could write on your website and then have those pages rank and then people would search for it. Well, what I've noticed in marketing over the last 10 years is the people have access to way more information than they ever have. And that's only going to get more so because of AI, right?
Yep.
Well, now it becomes a matter of, are you packaging your insights in the formats that your buyers prefer? So you mentioned, you know, podcasting attracts podcast listeners, the kinds of buyers that you want to work with. They're drawn to that medium, that channel, that format of consuming content. And so if you can package up your insights into podcast audio, video, and text-based formats, you're covering the range of different ways that your market consumes information.
For sure.
And so because there aren't as many podcasts in AEC, like you said, it is more of a blue ocean and you are a first or an early adopter in that space.
Yeah. So. I mean, that's my hope. Again, I don't know what best practices are out there that say like how much your audience should be growing month over month, year over year, episode over episode. We've definitely had a ton of growth, but it's nowhere near exponential yet, which is the other reason why we're going through the coaching, because I'm trying to figure that out. And again, when you romanticize this, when it's an idea in the back of your head or on the back of a bar napkin or in a planning session, you're like, hey, we should do a podcast. Yeah, that's going to solve all the revenue issues we've ever had because deals are just going to flow in and it's going to go viral. And like, I have a buddy who has a podcast and he's got a pretty big social media presence. He's in the real estate space and he had one video go viral. It was like a 20-second clip of a house that he bought, you know, he bought without seeing it. And it ended up being like a total dump. And this is the episode that went viral. So he's the idiot that bought the house without looking at it before in the world of viral fame.
Maybe so, viral fame isn't worth it. Maybe long sustained success is better.
It's for sure. I mean, I kind of joke about the viral moment and the Oprah Winfrey effect or the Tim Ferriss effect. Like, I don't want fame. I want just the right number of buyers and just the right number of recruits or future employees and teammates listening to us so that we can steadily continue growing our company. And like I said, and if this is a little bit easier or preps the battlefield for when our proposal goes into an RFP or whatever, then, you know, we're accomplishing the task. Me being an Instagram model, that went bye-bye a long time ago.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, BJ, I just want to say thank you so much for your time. This has been a great conversation. Is there anything that we didn't talk about that you'd like to touch on before we close out?
Yeah, I think let's hit fear.
Sure.
We launched the podcast in April of 21. The idea was in December of 20. I had somebody recording with me for 3 months. Just trying to get me comfortable being behind a microphone and my voice getting out there in the world. And I listened to the first podcast that I sent out, and I'm like, no way are we doing this. Like, I can't listen to myself. How can anybody else? To date, I've listened to zero of my podcasts since then, because it was just creating imposter syndrome or fear or whatever to what was probably an idea worth testing. And it's the other reason why I committed to 4 years. Once we went for it, I'm like, I'm not judging myself. I'm going to just do it, make it easy on myself to do it, get into a battle rhythm, get into a production, and just get better at it and treat it like, you know, let's end where we started. Treat it like laps in the pool or foul shots on the basketball court. Just keep at it. And just by doing it and showing up, you're going to get better and better at the activity. So I've definitely gotten more, you know, fluid in conversation. Still fall flat-footed on questions from time to time, and I still have edits and all of that. But I certainly have gotten more comfortable behind a microphone because I stopped paying attention to the outcome, and I just started to treat it as a craft that, for all of these reasons, you can get better at. I get to learn every day when I talk to somebody about something new. I get to get better in so many different ways by doing it. So the fear base was, I don't want to come across as some arrogant guy that knows it all and just wants to be self-promote-y. And the thought at the time was like, just the idea of you thinking you can have a podcast makes you arrogant. And it's like, no, actually, you probably have a little bit of experience that you can share with people. And you got a whole bunch of mentors that you can share their lessons with people by having them on the podcast. Actually, you're being selfish by not doing a podcast. So go do a podcast and get started. We can tell ourselves a lot of things that create fear in our minds. And, you know, you're kind of competing against some what if and what, you know, some ghost out there. So if I can leave everybody with something, it's don't let fear get in the way. If you feel called to do it or explore it, give yourself a long enough time horizon to get comfortable, a long enough and a good enough battle rhythm to get into a groove, and don't judge yourself too early.
Those are great pieces of advice. Yep, getting in a rhythm is key. And I like to say that if I can just get a little bit better with every episode that I publish, then the 100th episode is going to be much better than the first episode.
Amen.
So, BJ, thank you so much for your time. This has been a great conversation. If folks want to connect with you, where can they find you?
I'm pretty active on LinkedIn. So LinkedIn is definitely the best place, BJ Kraemer. And you can email me also, bkraemer, K-R-A-E-M-E-R at mcfaglobal.com.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time.
John, thank you. It was awesome. Had fun.